Good day and happy day to all of you. So here I am back again with a slightly different topic. You've always heard of this thing called competition, right? But when do we hear this word competition? As children, competition is what rank you are getting, how many marks you are getting. So you have to compete, you have to stand first in class, etc. Then you go higher up, competition to get into good colleges and good courses. Then competition to get a good job. And finally, competition with your rivals, with the other organizations, and how do you get a better share of the market? How do you do more selling? The bottom line, how much target you are given and how much turnover you have done, how much sales you have done with respect to your competitors, with respect to the other branches in your organization. And that's how it goes. So when we hear this word competition, normally we talk about professional or business competition. That is the most common area in which we talk about competition. In fact, if you doubt me, Google the word competition. You will get innumerable websites all talking about competition at the workplace. Commercial competition, companies, how do you compete and get a better share of the market? How do you get a better sales figure? So somehow it has been projected and it has been emphasized that competition is to do with making more money or going up the ladder or being successful in your workplace or in your business. But my vision on this is a little different. I feel there is more competition in your personal life than in your professional life. We don't even realize it. We hardly ever call it competition. Start with two small children in the same family. What we call as sibling rivalry. Sibling rivalry is nothing but competition. This is something which I have been emphasizing a lot to parents, that sibling rivalry is not to outdo the sibling, but to get better attention from the parent. Sometimes when parents come for counseling and say, I've got two children or more, and they're always fighting with each other. And they're screaming, saying, Mama, look at this fellow. Mama, look at this one. They make me so irritated. I tell them, yes, they are fighting with each other. What is the first thing that they do? They start screaming for Mama or Papa or whoever is around. So I tell them, next time you see your kids fighting and they are screaming, you just say, I have to go to the shop and buy something urgently and come back and walk out of the house. Quietly go around, come to the window at the back and peep in. You will see that they are happily playing with each other. Because there's no fun in fighting with your brother and sister if you can't, you know, get the attention of your parent. So that is competition to get attention of the parent, to convince the parent that I am right and she is wrong. So it starts from there. Then even in school, we talk about competition to get better marks or to get, you know, a good rank. No, it's not restricted to that. Competition is to make friends with the most popular guy. There are so many others who want to be a good friend of this fellow because he's some hero, he's some macho, he's some champion. And you are competing with the others so that you get more attention and more affection from that fellow who is supposed to be a hero. That is again competition. Sometimes it is competition just to get some notice or some nice comments from your teacher. So you go out of the way and you do something. You say, ma'am, we had got these chocolates. I brought one for you. The other one goes running and says, ma'am, can I, you know, clean the duster for you? It's got a lot of chalk dust on it. What are they doing? They are competing with each other to get better attention and affection from the teacher. That is the way it goes on. We don't even call it competition. We don't realize that it is competition, but it is. And then we grow up. There is competition to win over somebody whom you are attracted to. So I compete with the others. If I am a boy and I see a very pretty girl in our circle of social circle, I know that the other boys are also trying to win over her. So I make extra efforts to see if I can win over her and I can become her boyfriend. That is competition. Like this, it goes on and on and on. Even when children are grown up, many children still compete to get the attention and affection of their parents. Sometimes it's amazing. There is competition between mother-in-law and daughter-in-law to get the son's attention. Before marriage, this guy had only one female in his life, important female. That was his mother. He may have sisters, cousins, they are different. But the mother was the ultimate. And the mother was his anything and everything. Now he has acquired a wife. The wife is supposed to be his life partner. The wife is supposed to be having all his love and affection. But what happens? Sometimes the mother starts feeling insecure. She says, I had the undivided attention of my son. Now he seems to be spending most time with his wife and not with me. And so she starts competing with her daughter-in-law. If there are two daughters-in-law in a joint family, they are both competing for the attention of the mother-in-law. They have their own husbands. They have their own life partners. They should be happy. But knowing that the mother-in-law is the dominant factor in the family, they say, if I can get more attention, more affection, more love from the mother-in-law, I will be able to be one up from the other daughter-in-law. This is what I wanted to tell you before we actually come down to what competition is and how to deal with it, that there is more competition in personal life than there is in professional life. Professional life, what happens? Okay, you're competing for a job. You know that there's a very good company. Or before that, you're competing to get admission in a good college. So here we are, we have lakhs and lakhs and lakhs of students all over the country giving this JEE exam. They have this IIT dream. IITs have about 10 or 12,000 good engineering seats. And there are more than 10 lakhs competing for it. Percentage is not even 1%. When that happens, what happens to the balance 99%? They want to be engineers. We have enough and more good engineering colleges all over the country. So when they realize that they are not getting admission in IIT, they go to NIT, they go to VIT, they go to Bich Pilani, they go to so many other good engineering colleges, get in somewhere. And if they are good and bright and all-rounders, they sometimes overtake those who went to some top-notch colleges like IIT and make a better career for themselves. Same thing with professional competition. You've got a job and you are looking after one unit. There are 7 units in the company. The boss calls a meeting and checks out of the 7 who did very well. And you compete with the other 6. And you tell yourself that I should be number 1. I should get more praise, more rewards from the boss than the other 6 units. But it's after all a job. It's after all work. You're not, in most cases, you're not emotionally attached to it. So what do? You say these other two guys, I can never compete with them. Okay, if I hold the third rank among the seven, it's good enough for me. I won't really go out of the way to compete with them. But when it comes to personal competition, it becomes extremely important. A wife competing with her mother-in-law to get the love of her husband, her whole life depends on it. She will do everything 24/7 to get that thing. It's amazing to see sometimes even a father and mother compete for the love and affection of their child. I've heard parents saying that I do so much for my child, but he loves his father much more than me. Father is not doing as much as I am doing, but whatever I am doing for my child is not acknowledged. The child is always running behind the father. Now, as we all know, father has a role and mother has a role. They are complementary roles. They are not competitive roles. But people do compete without even realizing that you are competing. So that is the reason why I thought that we shall understand competition from the point of view of your personal life. So that's why I gave the topic competition and competitors in life. Are you aware who is your competitor? Is it a sibling? Is it your mother? Is it your spouse? Many a time, these are the people who are competing with you. And if they win over you, they get a better lot. It actually affects your whole life, not just your career or your increment or your promotions. So let's understand that competition is not bad. Firstly, let's accept that. Competition can act as a motivator. So if I'm heading 1 out of 7 units, I say I must aim to become first. Okay, if there are 2 which are very good and far above me, at least I should hold the third rank. I should not slip down below that. Same thing in personal life. I must not let go. The mother says I must not let go of my son. I must pay more attention to him. I should give him more affection and love so that he remains attached to me. So you see, sometimes competition oftentimes can be a motivator. So competition by itself is not bad. Competition is actually something which spurs you into action, which makes you more motivated. But the most important thing is you must understand that if we overdo competition, it can hurt us. Actually, it is the same in any aspect of human life. Anything which you do, you know, like an obsession, and anything which you do where you only want this. See, in professional also, there are children who come and say, I want to go only to IIT. They don't say, I want to be an engineer. They say, I want to be an IITian. Now, if they become so obsessed with this IIT dream, and if they just miss out, as I told you, there are 10 lakh, 20 lakh people competing with me for 10,000 seats. So however good I am, I may just slip down by a few ranks and I don't get it. And I go into depression and I say, I am no good. I couldn't make it. I studied so hard. I went for coaching. I studied till 2 o'clock in the night every day. Still, I couldn't make it. And that was because the goal that was set was IIT. Same thing happens in personal life. If you set a goal which is, you know, flexible, like in professional life, you may say, I want to become a competent engineer. How do I do that? I do that by going into a good engineering college. So which are the good engineering colleges? A, B, C, D, E. If I can't get into A, I go into B. If I can't get into B, I go to C. If I don't get into C, I go into D. Then your competition, instead of getting into D, if you get into C, you'll feel happy. But if you had made only A as your objective and you get into B also, you're still unhappy. So in personal life, if there's a child who says, I want all the attention of my parent, I don't want my parent to love my sibling, obviously he is going to be disappointed. That sort of competition, you know, can be very, very harmful to the person. In fact, even if, let's say, he gets all the attention of his parent, he has succeeded in his goal, the moment the parent slips 5%, up till now the parent was giving me 100% attention. If the parent gives 5% attention to my sibling, I get upset. I'm getting 95% attention from my parent, whereas it should have been 50-50. It is 95 and 5, but I'm not happy. Because I had set my goal saying, my parent should only love me and not my sibling. Sometimes there are children who are jealous of their own parent. If they find that the father is giving too much love to the mother and the mother is reciprocating, the child gets angry. Child says, this is my mother. I want full attention from her. Why is she giving so much attention to her husband? That's my father. But we can't take it. So, as I said, competition can be a motivator and inspiration. Competition can also be something which pulls you down. So the first thing to do is review all your relationships. Personal competition is to do with people, not to do with inanimate object. That is a completely different thing. And when you do that, you find that you are getting sidetracked. So, list out all the people whom you care for. List out the people who are important to you. List out the people whom you love. And see if there is an element of competition in it. Am I competing with somebody else who also wants to have a close relationship with the same person? Once you make that list, be realistic. Like I said, I have a sibling and I have a parent. Now, I want love and affection from my parent. My sibling also wants love and affection from the same parent. And my sibling has equal right to get attention. So if I realize that I am competing with my sibling for my parent's attention, that means there's something wrong. If I want more attention and affection from my parent, let me do it directly. Not to put my sibling down and climb over his shoulder and get more love and affection. It never works. So you tell yourself, I love my parent. I would be very happy if my parent gives me love and affection. So I am going to go out of the way to give more love and affection to my parent and hope that I will get reciprocation. Competition, good competition also, you know, leads to creativity and innovation. Which are the different ways can I try doing something else? Take sales. Some of the best salesmen who have really outbeaten all competition and gone all the way up, they did not do things the way their competitors did. They found out a different way of doing it. One of the most popular, salesmen of cars in USA decided that he is not going to target customers who don't have cars or who have a very old car and are likely to get into the market to buy a car. All salesmen were looking for such people, right? You know what he did? He would make a list of people who have already bought cars recently. Now, a person has bought a car 1 month back. Why waste your time? He's not going to buy a car from you. But you know what he would do? he would go and tell them, you bought a car last month. Are you happy with it? Is it running well? Do you have any problems? That man would be amazed that he has nothing to gain from me. He's not trying to sell another car to me, but why is he showing me so much of attention, and why is he coming and meeting up with me? So he becomes a good friend. And when he starts talking, he would say, if any of your friends need a car, can you please recommend me? Here is my visiting card. And innumerable people started becoming his unpaid assistants in sales. The moment they hear somebody, or the moment they would see a friend who's got an old car, and the discussion would go, why don't you think of replacing that and buying a new car? The first thing this one would say is, go to such and such person. He is an excellent salesman. He will get you the correct car at the correct price. So this is what I meant by saying that when you do things differently, then and then only, you can beat the competition. And by learning more of life skills, you automatically learn more of getting into better situations in life. To be able to do that, I want you to do a little bit of introspection into this. Firstly, like I said, you make out a list of who are the people you are competing with. So Anis has prepared a nice systematic slide. She will show it to you now. Doing this introspection, what are the competition and competitors of real life, not just professional life? Do you compete with, that is, whom do you compete with? Do you compete with your siblings? I know of people who are 40, 60, 80 years old, and they're still competing with their sibling. They're not even aware of it. So start identifying. Do you compete with your colleagues at work? Not just for getting an increment or promotion, but for various other things. Maybe some social activities, maybe some cultural activities, maybe getting the eye of the boss, or maybe being popular. So do you compete with colleagues at work? Similarly, do you compete with your neighbors, friends, all these people? Many of us do that without even realizing that we are doing it. So think over, list out your friends, list out your neighbors, and ask yourself, is there anybody in this list that I am actually competing with? Then, of course, relatives, cousins, uncle, aunt, so and so, whoever is there, it could even be your parents or your children, whoever it is. Another interesting thing, do you compete with celebrities? See, advertising people use this as a very, very strong point. They will show a very handsome cricket player or a very beautiful movie star, in front of a huge building condominium which they are trying to sell. And suddenly you start thinking that I can deal with them if I buy an apartment in this. They are 100 times or 500 times richer than you. And they are not even buying, they are just lending their face to that advertisement. But innumerable people get carried away. That's the reason why business people spend not lakhs but crores of rupees to get these celebrities to just pose with that product or that building or the car or whatever it is. So ask yourself, am I getting carried away and I'm competing with those celebrities and saying, I also want to be like them? Once you have made your list, then you ask yourselves, which of these are constructive competition? Which of these are spurring me on, motivating me, so that I am getting more and more, feeling positive, feeling energetic to perform better, to make better efforts? And what are the outcomes you have seen so far? When you identify that, even if I'm not doing it now, once upon a time, I used to compete with my sibling. What did it lead to? Finally, what was the positive outcome? and what was the negative outcome of that competition. If you do this introspection, you will get a very clear picture where you stand, what are your habits, how you maintain, you know, interpersonal relationships, which ones of them are thriving and blossoming and giving you a better life, and which one of them are becoming toxic or bad or irritating. Because as I keep reminding you every now and then, the one single factor that contributes towards your well-being, happiness, fulfillment, and success is how good relationships you have. The better the relationships you have, the better. And I'm not just talking about close relationships. You have a nearby shopkeeper. You have a security guard in your building. You have a bus conductor if you travel by bus. And with them also, if you go beyond that basic transaction of buying, selling, if you start making a personal relationship with them, what happens is that your quality of life improves, your day goes much better, because you step out and you have somebody, your security guard, waving out to you because you've taken the trouble of finding out about him, checking about his family or his child or his old mother or whatever it is. With the shopkeeper, you have been a little extra nice. You've shown concern for him. You've said that, oh, the shop is so hot and nowadays the summer is so bad. It must be bad, you know, for hours and hours just have to sit in the shop because there's nobody to relieve you. He takes that extra care for you. Life becomes pleasant, even if something unpleasant is happening to you. Even if you're going through a tough time in home or office, that little transactions where that person smiles at you, there will be people who will wave out to you from a distance. There will be people who walk that 10 extra steps to greet you. And that happens because you are not competing. It is not that you are competing with someone to get somebody's attention. You're just being nice to that person. And that is the reason why I said that as much as possible, if you can minimize your relationships which are competition related, if you can minimize that, what happens is that the other relationships become very pleasant and very nice. At the same time, a word of caution. There are people who do not compete at all. They are totally laid back. They say, I don't care what everybody is doing. I am doing what I want to do and I'm not bothered about anybody. Fine. If you're taking care of yourself, you're not running into debt and you're not dependent on anybody, it is fine. There's nothing wrong with it. But remember that because of that attitude, you're losing relationships. When you don't care for people, people don't care for you. And sometime or the other, you feel that gap. You feel, when I want to talk to somebody, there's nobody available. When I want to go out with someone, nobody comes with me. Nobody cares for me. See, people are so selfish. People are not actually selfish. It is you who has created that sort of relationship with them that they say, no, I'm not bothered about this person. I don't feel the need to be close to that person. So that is the flip side of it. There are very few people who do that. But in case somebody is doing it, caution them also. And those who are getting too much into competition, caution them also. So that is my message to you today. It is 2:30 and Purni is here to say hi to you. And I'm sure a lot of you would be waiting to say hi to Purni. I'll be back soon.
Hi. A good afternoon to each of you. And interesting topic, no? Competition, competitors, and competition leads us to run the race, come first, if not first, at least second. So this keeps happening all the time. Hi. So this keeps happening all the time. So for you to decide whether I want to be competitive, I don't want to be competitive, what is it that I want to do, it is very important that you are mindful. I share you, right? So you have to be mindful. So what we have done is Banjara Academy under the umbrella and Ali steering the workshop, we are having a workshop on mindfulness, to be very mindful, to be very alert about, you know, to be in the present and to know that, hey, do I do this? I don't do this. Do I want it too much, too good, too bad? So many things are there. All these things are going to be addressed in our workshop. It's a classroom workshop. Okay. So you have to come to classroom, take the effort of having your breakfast, picking up an auto or a bus or a car or whatever, and coming to the academy, telling us a hi, and we telling you a hi. So all these things are going to take place. If you choose to come for the mindfulness workshop, which is on Saturday, we are going to have very limited seats because it is going to be an intense workshop. Okay, so in case you or anyone else wants to enroll for this workshop, please call up the numbers which are given here and ensure that you are here on that day. We are not going to be having any last minute enrollment, just rushing in, pushing in and all. Nothing of that sort is going to happen because it is going to be a concentrated capsule on mindfulness, being in the present. Okay. So that's something you can even spread the message to others. And another thing that happens in Banjara, where you have no competition, no competitors, you can do what you want to do, and you are the only one who is into the competition of your own selected, elected race, is, tell me what? Yes, joining the Diploma in Counseling Skills. So DCS, basically, most of you all must be knowing about this course by now. We have no theory, we have no exams, we have no syllabus, we have no short answers, no long answers, no master following or no dissertation and fixing up and making a paper, nothing like that at all. What we have is a process by which every student enjoys learning. So when you enjoy learning, there is no question of, you know, having any kind of an exam, unit test, semesters, final exams, nothing. So there is no competition. There are no competitors there at all. Hi, Sri Devi. There are no competitors at all for our Diploma in Counseling Skills. Admissions are on full swing. See, we have assessment process, okay? But we firmly believe that there are not going to be any tests, any unit tests, any semesters, nothing at all. No preparations, no preparatories, no finals, nothing. Assessment happens through the whole year. There are no grades because grades divide people, no? Your best friend and you will be there and then she'll get more marks than you and then you'll go like, ooh, I didn't get good marks, you know, something like that and all happens. So we don't even want to give any grades, any marks, nothing at all, any first class, second class. But each student in doing DCS is given feedback. Okay, so they are given feedbacks where the assessors, they've got a wonderful fleet of assessors also. So Anish will put up the poster again of DCS. I would just like to quickly take you through that because I think, if I may speak for myself, it is a life-changing experience. Because it is made with so much of thoughtfulness, you know. And this is the 26th year. And it's part-time. You need to come only 2 days in a week. And hands-on practical. So there is no question of propounding any theory or, you know, anything like that, nothing at all like that. What we will be doing is putting you directly into hands-on practical work. So no competition, no competitors. Enjoy the process with our diploma in counseling skills. And if you have questions, thoughts, opinions, clarifications, over to Ali in just a jiffy. Bye, see you soon. Thank you for all the lovely highs. Bye-bye.
Yes, I'm working a lot on this mindfulness. 1st of June, we have this workshop. I have been working in mindfulness for a very long time. In fact, we were trained by an Indian origin professor who is with University of California, Berkeley. And she had come here to ISB in Hyderabad, and I was also invited there to do a workshop. And we met there, and she offered that she'll come to Bangalore and give us a training. So we were trained by her, and we've got a lot of training material which she gave me. So I've been working on that. And 1st of June, we are doing this workshop to start off with. And if it goes well, I would like to get deeper and deeper into mindfulness. And mindfulness is something which takes you away from competition, because you focus on yourself and you focus on the now. I'm not saying that you become asocial or antisocial, but when you focus on yourself, you automatically start building better relationships, because you know what your needs and wants are. Okay. So with that, let us start off. Surekha, yes, she's always there with some very, very enlightening comments. So Surekha says, when you compete with another person, you negate the thrashing of winter win outcomes. Yes, there are different opinions on it, Surekha, as you know. And as I said earlier also, there's a positive side of competition, there's a negative side of competition. Everything goes by that. And what we need to do is to balance. We neither go to this extreme nor we go to that extreme. You don't become, you know, bindas and say, I don't care where the world is going. And you don't look at the other side where you are perpetually competing with somebody else. The next is Roshan. Competition is important as it motivates us to do well. But I believe in competing with myself. Yes, that's a very nice approach. To do better in every way, every day. If I have achieved this goal, then I am satisfied. Yes. And this is a goal which you can never achieve, no? You want to be better every way, every day. So it's a continuous thing. Keep on with it. Kalpana says, at times I'm happy to compete with myself. I mean the past me and the present me and the future me. This helps me to grow in my own eyes. Is this a right approach? Definitely it is the right approach, Kalpana. And this is part of what we do in mindfulness. That is to look at your past, to look at your future, pull them together, condense them, and put them into the present me. So if you are mindful of your present status, what you have achieved and lost in the past, what you want to achieve and which you may not achieve in the future, and you become contented with where you are today. Sridevi says, good afternoon, Ali. Such an apt topic when board results are out, yes. Whether it's personal or professional competition, societal expectation can be burdensome. How to balance the pressure and embrace the competition and rise beyond it? I gave you a little hint. I'll expand on it. I showed you the slide which Anis had made. That is, you know, find out, introspect on whom you compete with. Are you competing with the people who are trying to get into IIT or MBBS or whatever? Are you competing with your brother or sister that I will get better marks and I will do better over there? Are you competing with your neighbors or your friends to say that my daughter got more marks in the exam than your daughter got. The moment you make that list and you do that two little steps which I told you through the slide, that is, which ones are constructive competition and which ones are destructive? And what were the outcomes so far? We have all competed. Throughout life, we have been competing. But if we can now stop, introspect, go back into the past and review. When I was having simpler rivalry, what do I achieve by that? When I was competing to get into this college or this course, what did I achieve by that? When I was competing with my neighbor to say that I have a better car than he has, so I will buy a more expensive car, what did I achieve by that? The moment you start balancing and looking at things that way, you know what happens is you automatically start creating a balance that this is where competition is good or constructive, and this is where competition is bad or destructive. Then, next one, we have Mamta. Mamta is saying, competition by family is quite disheartening. As I feel, competing with colleagues, fellow beings, and neighbors is quite common and a bit constructive. But competing with family members might lead to a chaotic and disturbed life. Yes, to a great extent, I agree with you, Mamta, but we cannot put a blanket thing on it. We cannot say competing with family members is always destructive. Sometimes it is healthy also. Remember that. If you have a sibling, remember as a child, and your sibling learned how to do cycling, and you competed and said, hey, he's becoming very popular and everybody is praising him because he has learned cycling. Let me also learn cycling. So now you are competing with your own brother or sister, and the result is you're learning something new, which otherwise you may have not have really taken the trouble to learn. So that's what I said, that when you have that attitude of constructive criticism, whether it is within your family or whether it is outside, when you do this introspection that this is where I will not compete. I will not compete to buy a more expensive car than my neighbor just to show off. That is destructive. But I will compete in such and such thing in order to make sure that I get what I want or to build a better quality of life. Sharayu from Dharwad. Be sportive in approach. Both can be faced more effectively without hurting. Yes, Dr. Sharayu, it is a very, very understanding thing that what we call as the sporting spirit. When you play a game, you're obviously competing. You have a cricket team which is playing against the opponent's team. So you have to be competitive. You say, I will get better marks. I will take more wickets. I will see that my score is better than the opposing team's score. And you prepare, you practice, you're very alert. And sometimes you achieve, sometimes you don't. And if you have that sporting spirit which says, I played well, I played up to my capacity, but the team played better than me. So they won the match. It could be individual, it could be as a team. But this thing called sporting spirit, and that's one of the advantages of being a sports person. If you learn that sporting spirit, the true sporting spirit, sometimes it gets very ugly when people start, you know, getting into unnecessary, unhealthy competition in sports also. But if it is true, genuine, you know, competition with your opponents in the field of sports, you really learn a lot and you really keep progressing also. Bina says, regarding selection for courses, the whole world thrives on competitive basis, exams, etc. Disappointment, depression for students is a great problem. They can undergo anything harmful. Counseling to them is very important from very young age. That's a very nice word you have said, Bina. From a very young age, you can't counsel them when they have appeared for JEE and they have not been selected. But when the person is in sixth standard, instead of sending him for JEE coaching, give him more life skills training, help him to understand, is this the right career for you? What would you like to do? Make the person be realistic. How good marks are you getting? To what level can you compete? What is the type of college or institution you are likely to get admission in? How you can compete and improve that by a few notches so that you get into a better college? And then have plan B, plan C. If you don't get into A, you get into B, you get into C. Nothing matters. Sometimes even graduates of C-level colleges overtake the graduates of A-level colleges. As long as you're working hard, you're committed, and you have the aptitude for what you've selected. That should be the spirit. I agree with you. Yes. So I just wanted to tell you, again, repeat the same thing. That is that competition between two people, if it is healthy, as I gave the example of what we call as the sporting spirit, that creates a good thing. Meena has also mentioned that schools should do this counseling. Yes, thankfully, there are a few schools who are doing it, and I'm very happy that they've taken the initiative. But there are many more schools which are not doing it. They just consider that I finish the portions, I teach properly, I prepare the child for the exam, and as long as the child gets very high marks, my school is competing with other schools. So I tell them, see, we had so many marks, we had so many toppers, we had so many students who got distinction, so many who got first class. What happens to them after that? Some schools are not bothered. As long as they can put out an ad the moment results come, saying in our school we had so many top marks and distinctions and first class. That's not the right way of thinking. What are they doing? Instead of encouraging their students to have healthy competition, they are succumbing to competition with the other schools. I want more admissions. I want more people coming to me. Maybe I can get better fees or better donations or whatever it is if I show such high results. That is very sad. And these are the type of people who do not do this type of counseling, which I think every child needs. Counseling should not be restricted only to, you know, people who have a crisis or people who are depressed. There's a lot of counseling that can be done very effectively if it is done towards building up, towards improving developmental counseling. A lot can be done in that area. Teaching children life skills, for example, that itself is a great boon. There are schools who are doing it, and I really am, you know, thankful to them. But there are schools who have not understood, because life skills is not going to contribute towards the percentage of the child. So that's why they are not doing it. Those who are not doing it, I hope at least in future they will do it. And if you are concerned about children, even if you are not running a school or you are not a teacher, please do it individually with the children. That is good enough. Many children who are not getting these inputs from schools can get it outside school, can get it in family, can get it. Make a group of few parents who get together, and some of them have some good knowledge about you know, life skills and all these things. So train the children, give them that inputs. We had a two-week program called Young's, in which we did by play method, with fun, we taught them life skills. We taught them how to compete. We taught them how to be confident about themselves. We taught them about how to build their self-esteem. All these things we do, that is our contribution. And I feel you can do it as an individual, as a group of adults, or if you happen to be a teacher or educator, even more so, you can do it. Keep working on that too. These are things which are to be done on a continuous basis. It's not a one-time thing, as many people think, that once some counseling has been done, it is over. No, it's not like that. It has to be done on a continuous basis, and it should start with small children and go on till they make their own life and they settle down and they decide what direction to give their life in. So with that, let me also wind up today. And Anis is right now going to tell you what we are going to do next Saturday. That is a very, you know, twisted topic. Growing old while you are young. Who wants to grow old when you are young? But what do you mean that you are young? And what do you mean that you are old? The very concept of young and old can have many different connotations. I'm going to start with that. I'm going to help you to understand whether you are 16 or 60 or 90, it doesn't matter. Do you consider yourself old? What is old? And do you consider yourself young? If so, what is young? That is what I'm already preparing on it. If you have any inputs, please feel free to send it to me or call me up and tell me. We will work on this and we shall meet on Saturday, the 18th of May at 2 o'clock with this topic, growing old while you are young. And just as a recap, I'll request Anis to show you that slide which showed you how to introspect on competition. You have a look at it once more and then we can wind up. Thank you and bye-bye.